Apple's strategy is really simple. What we want to do is we want to put an incredibly great computer in a book that you can carry around with you that you can learn how to use in 20 minutes.
Hey guys, how are you all doing? Really? That's just great. You know, I'm doing pretty great today too because today is the 10th anniversary of when Steve Jobs revealed the iPad to the public. Fun fact, this is actually one of the first iPads ever sold, and it still works just fine. I stood in line, actually at the front of the line, early in the morning on launch day, and I tell you, that was an experience I will never forget. But there was a lot that went into the iPad's development. There's a lot of history here. And as the speculated announcement date drew near, the hype, the buzz, and the rumors were just brewing like crazy. So let's take a look at the history of the iPad. In 1968, computer scientist and former Apple fellow, Alan Kay, created the Dynabook concept, which was a thin portable computer. Throughout the years, it went through several conceptual iterations, but it was never made into an actual product. But many believe, myself included, that this was at least part of the inspiration for an Apple tablet device. Heck, even after the iPhone keynote in 2007, Steve showed the iPhone to Alan, and Alan gestured his hands into the shape of a tablet, saying, "Steve, make it this size and you'll rule the world." So I think it's fair to say there was some inspiration from Alan. Anyway, jumping back to the past, now to 1983, Steve Jobs gave a speech at IDCA and said, "Apple wants to put an incredibly great computer in a book that you can carry around with you, that you can learn how to use in 20 minutes. Arguably, many could say that this was one of the earliest mentions of the iPad's super early infancy. Perhaps when he said book, he was referring to a form factor like the PowerBook 100, which came out in 1991, but I like to believe that he had more of a tablet form factor in mind. Also, Marcel Brown has a great article about this speech and a full recording of it too, so I highly recommend giving it a listen, because for the most part, it predicted the future. Also in 1983, Apple worked with Frog Design to mock up another tablet prototype called Bashful. And in 1988, Apple created a video about a concept product named Knowledge Navigator. This is another awesome gem to watch because it shows off an iPad-like product with Siri and FaceTime features. Stuff we all use today. Well, maybe except for Siri. Hey, cool it, okay? Cool it, I was just kidding! Now between 1992 and 1993, while the Newton team was hard at work, other people at Apple were working to bring the Macintosh user interface to a tablet-like computer. This resulted in many different concepts, the first one being Penlight, which was based on the PowerBook Duo, then Pen Mac followed after that. There was also the Macintosh Folio and the Bic, and honestly, if you just sit down with the Apple design book, you'll see a plethora of tablet concepts. There's so many things in here, we could do other episodes on this later. Ultimately, all of these tablets were killed in favor of the Newton Message Pad, which was released in 1993. Also in the same year, Apple developed a prototype named Walt, which integrated the touch kind of environment with a stylus, PowerBook 100 internals, and phone-like functionality. But again, it was ultimately killed. The Newton line only lasted for several years, and the last Newton product was the MessagePad 2100, which was released in 1997 and discontinued in 1998. That was the end of the Newton line. So Apple took many stabs at this whole tablet idea, and you'll notice a lot of them were based on styluses and pen input. There wasn't much actual finger touch support, and ultimately that's where Apple wanted to go, just like what we have today with multi-touch technology. But you also have to remember, in the mid to late 90s, Apple was in a lot of financial trouble, and Steve Jobs wasn't back at the company until 1997. He helped restructure the board and build a new strategy, and Apple got back on their feet. They went on to release the iPod and the iMac and all this great stuff. But during all of that, there was no talk about this tablet, or there was very little talk about the tablet outside of Apple. It seems like the buzz kind of went down a little bit. Where did it go? Well, it turns out Apple was still interested in the tablet, but they put it on pause to focus on a new product category target, and that was the phone. Apple was working on a multi-touch display in the early 2000s, but they shelved the tablet product in favor of a phone because they thought that was more important at the time. There's actually a great All Things Digital interview where Steve Jobs tells the story behind this decision.
I actually started on a tablet first, and I asked our folks, could we come up with a multi-touch display? And about 6 months later, they called me in and showed me this prototype display. And it was amazing. Now, we were thinking about building a phone at that time. And when I saw the rubber band, inertial scrolling, and a few of the other things, I thought, oh my God, we can build a phone out of this.
So the iPhone went on to sell pretty darn well. I mean, it's still around today. It's super popular. So with that experience, it looks like Apple learned a lot about touch and they were ready to go back to the tablet project. And as speculations about the tablet project drew near, rumors, buzz, hype, fan-made concepts all started to flourish. Names like iSlate and iTablet were tossed around a lot, probably because Apple purchased iSlate.com in 2007. More rumors started brewing when iProd 01 and iProd 11 appeared in property lists inside of the iPhone OS 3.0 betas back in 2009. Fun fact, this was actually the first topic I covered on my tech webcast many years ago. Goodness, I was such a geek. Anyway, some sites predicted the tablet would be 10.7 inches. Some speculated as to whether or not it would run iPhone OS or Mac OS X. And some sites predicted Apple would use the ARM Cortex architecture for the processor, which they actually did. Many people were also speculating about the price. Some were saying $800, but a lot of people were saying just under $1,000, which is code for $999. I was prepared for the worst. But all those name speculations we were talking about were about to die. Records surfaced showing Apple was pursuing the name iPad, but Fujitsu filed an application for iPad in March 2003. No, we're not talking about the Mad TV iPad.
Why use a MaxiPad when there's the new iPad from Apple? I just hook up my Apple to my Peach.
But in the end, Apple was able to use the name, so I guess everybody's happy? Hopefully. Then on January 18th, Apple issued the invitations for their January 27th media event. Come see our latest creation. The hype was on. Then the day comes. The buzz was going out of control. I remember being in high school on January 27th, dying to see what the device looked like. I was in class just waiting and waiting and waiting. Then, less than an hour before Steve Jobs took the stage, a photo surfaced on Gizmodo. It showed the tablet's alleged rear shell, which many believed was authentic. And if you recall the final design of the first-gen iPad, you would agree. So this is it. This is the moment coming up where Steve Jobs is going to walk out on stage and reveal the iPad to the world for the first time. But as with pretty much everything new, it was bound to be met with some criticism. Steve Jobs took the stage and asked everybody in the audience if there's room for a third category of device between a laptop and a smartphone. And after poking fun at netbooks, he revealed the iPad, a 9.7 inch tablet powered by Apple's A4 system on a chip. Some people were like, what? Don't call it an iPad, that sounds like a tampon. And many people said it was just a giant iPhone.
We took an iPod Touch and made it bigger.
I won't lie, that's what my brain said when I first saw it too, but I wasn't so quick to dismiss the product. Additionally, others poked fun at Apple for calling it magical. But the iPad went on to sell over 360 million units within the first decade, so early criticisms aside, I think it did all right. The design was half an inch thin and it weighed only 1.5 pounds. It featured an IPS display, a 10-hour battery, and it even came in a 3G option. It didn't have a camera built in, which may have disappointed some people, but don't worry, they'll fix that real soon. An interesting thing to note is the 30-pin connector. This worked similarly to the port on the iPhone and the iPod. Additionally, Apple shipped a dock accessory for the iPad, including one that had a keyboard built in. But that's not the interesting part. The interesting part is that a later stage iPad prototype had two 30-pin connectors, signifying that Apple toyed with the idea of docking the iPad in portrait and landscape orientations. But this idea was scrapped. On the software side, the iPad ran iPhone OS 3.2. This was before it was called iOS. And it could run iPhone apps natively without modification. But Apple encouraged developers to redesign their app UIs to take advantage of the big screen. Additionally, the built-in apps were redesigned versions of the iPhone apps, and they adopted a more skeuomorphic user interface, which eventually leaked its way into the iPhone and onto Mac OS X. This led to some debates down the road, but believe me, that's a topic for a future video. Apple also released an iPad version of the iWork suite, and they released iBooks, so you could use the iPad as an e-reader. But one of the biggest surprises was the cost. Again, many were speculating that it would be around $999, but when Apple showed the true price, it was met with applause.
Not at $999, but at just $499.
Through the following years, the iPad received many updates, including the iPad Mini and the iPad Pro, and hundreds of millions of units sold. A lot of work went into this device to finally bring it to market. And, you know, I just want to remind you that success has many fathers, right? It wasn't just Steve Jobs that made the iPad or Apple that made the iPad. There was a lot of people involved with it inside and outside of Apple, from inspiration to R&D and everything else in between. But it ended up shaping a pretty freaking cool product that many people still use today. Heck, I still use one. I have all of my episode notes on here, so when I'm talking with you guys, I don't sound like too much of an idiot, right? So it helps me out every day. Let me know about your own iPad stories, though. I want to hear them because I am a curious cat. And if you have any other ideas for future topics you want to see on the show, do let me know down below. I'm all ears. Thanks for sticking with me. Catch the crazy and pass it on.